بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبعد. This is lesson number 14 from the three fundamental principles of الأصول الثلاثة. And inshallah today we'll be starting with الأصل الثاني, which is the second principle. The second principle is معرفة دين الإسلام بالأدلة. معرفة, we went over that in the beginning. معرفة is to know. عرفة يعرف. معرفة دين الإسلام. معرفة دين الإسلام. So دين is a, it comes from the فعل دان يدينو. And you say دانا رجل إذا خضع وظل. So if he lowers himself and humbles himself, then you would say that, you know, called دانا يدينو. And it goes back, and this is of course something that we're ordered in Islam, because we have to humble ourselves and lower ourselves to the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and accepting the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and putting the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first. So we don't put what our wishes and our desires first. So this is the meaning of al-khudur, that we lower ourselves and humble ourselves, and we realize that, you know, our desires and our wishes, they're nothing if they're not in accordance with the kitab wa sunnah and with the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger. So, and this, of course, this is what Islam is about, and as we're going to see, inshallah, in a second. So, dana yadinu. And because as we know, we're in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is not in need of us. So we need to have that type of level of khudu. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Ya ayyuha nasu antum al-fuqara ila Allah. Wallahu huwa al-ghaniyu al-hamid. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala huwa al-ghani. Al-ghani is he's rich. And he's not just rich in a way that he has wealth or anything of that nature, but because everything belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And al-ghani here, it means al-ghina al-mutlaq. You know, al-ghina al-mutlaq, it means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is like wealthy, and he's in no need of anybody. From all aspects, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not in need of us. That we are we're the ones that are in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because our faqr, our poverty, and our need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is also mutlaq in all aspects. That we're faqir. We don't have knowledge if we're not taught. We don't have money and food and everything if we're not provided for, either through working or as you're a young child, if your parents aren't providing. All that comes from Allah. So in every single sense, every aspect of our lives, we have that we're impoverished, but we think that we're not. So part of Islam is to come to that realization. When we talk about a deen, we're talking about a khudur. We're talking about like actually realizing your reality, your actual nature. And your nature is that you are faqir. No matter how much money that you have on this earth, you have nothing. You have all of this is the possessions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't possess anything. The knowledge that we've gained about the religion or even about the dunya is knowledge that was given to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The whatever experience that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written that we go through, where we gain this knowledge throughout our life, that was a gift from Allah. Everything that we have, our health and our wealth and everything that we have, is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we're in need of Him 100%. So this is al-faqr al-mutlaq. That means that we're in complete state of poverty. Poverty, it completely encompasses us. It's our nature. So when we say that like al-faqir al-mutlaq, it means that this is the nature of the person. This is nature. It's our nature. And until we actually come to grips with that nature, and we come to grips that also with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is al-ghina al-mutlaq. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, lahu mulku samawati wal-ar. He has all the dominions of the heavens and the earth, all belong to Him. And He does whatever He pleases with all of that. And we can't do anything except for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written. Even with our own wealth. Even with our own wealth. You're not going to go out and do anything beneficial with Allah subhanahu, with your money unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives you the tawfiq to do that. And He puts it in your heart to want to do good and gives you the ikhlas and gives you all of these are gifts from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to understand our nature. So when we talk about going into Islam and understanding Islam, before we even understand Islam, we have to understand our own nature. Our own nature is that we are completely in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not in need of us. And it goes back to the hadith of Abi Dharr radiallahu anhu. And I'm not going to go over the whole hadith, but I'll go over the part that's relevant to this part of the discussion, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrated this hadith from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, "Ya ibadi, law anna awwalakum wa akhirakum wa insakum wa jinnakum kanu ala atqa qalbi rajulin wahidin minkum ma zada dhalika fi mulki shay'an." يا عبادي لو أن أولكم وآخركم وإنسكم وجنكم كانوا على أفجر قلب رجل واحد منكم ما نقص ذلك من ملك شيئا. يا عبادي لو أن أولكم وآخركم وإنسكم وجنكم قاموا في صعيد واحد فسألوني فأعطيت كل إنسان مسألته ما نقص ذلك مما عندي إلا كما ينقص المخيط إذا أدخل البحر. يا عبادي إنما هي أعمالكم أحصيها لكم. The last part of the hadith. Okay, so he said right here, Ya ibadi, O my servants, if the first of, from amongst you and the last from the first of creation to the last of creation and the humans from amongst you and the jinn from amongst you were on the most pious of all hearts, you are on complete taqwa. That would not increase the dominions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala anything. It would not increase anything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has from amongst his and within his dominion, which is everything. He said, Ya ibadi, lo anna awalakum. So even if the first amongst you, from the first of creation to the last of creation, and the humans and the jinn, كانوا على أفجر قلب رجل واحد منكم, and they were on the most evil of hearts, the most disobedient of hearts, amongst, similar to the most disobedient person from amongst you. ما نقص ذلك من ملك شيء, and that will not decrease anything from the dominions of Allah. So nothing that we do, or nothing that we don't do, whatever we do is for ourselves, it's to benefit ourselves. And whatever we do in disobedience, it's against ourselves, and we have to answer and we're held accountable for. It does not affect what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has. Okay, and then he said, in the last part, he said, Ya ibadi, so the first of creation to the last of creation and the humans and the jinn, قَامُوا فِي سَعِيدٍ وَاحِدٍ, if all of you were to stand up on a raised area, all of you from the beginning of creation and at the last of creation, and all of you asked me, you know, everybody went up and raised their hands and asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for something, and Allah gave them every single person exactly what he asked, مَا نَقَصَ ذَلَكَ مِمَّا عِنْدِي, he said, that will not decrease anything from which I have, إِلَّا كَمَا يَنْقُصُ الْمِخْيَطِ. المخيط is used for al-khayt, it's the sewing needle. He's saying that if you were to dip the sewing needle into the ocean, he said, the amount of water that came out with the mikhyat, with the sewing needle, that would be similar to like how you would decrease the dominions from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Ibn Rajab, Allah yarhamu, when he spoke about this hadith, he's saying what he explained, and I'm not giving the exact wording, but the meaning, and you can go back to Jami' al-Ulum wal-Hikam and you review this. He said that this does not mean that, you know, because obviously if you dip a sewing needle into the water, that some water will actually come off on the needle. That you have decreased the ocean in some regards, even if it's a drop, right? But he's saying with the dominions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you don't even decrease even that much. But this was used as an example so the person can understand that, you know, obviously, because basically you with the needle, you come with nothing. You just come with a drop of water on the needle, which is nothing in compared to the ocean. But in reality, you don't decrease anything from the dominion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave every single person everything that he has. Nothing is decreased from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has. Nothing. Because everything that Allah, everything is from the dominions of Allah, and everything is controlled and belongs to Allah. And nothing decreases. Nothing will ever decrease. So that's the whole point. Like, we're the ones that we're in need. So we have to understand our nature going into Islam and understanding what Islam is. Because if you go in with the type of attitude that, I have rights and I have this and I'm, you don't have this like, what's this attitude that they use nowadays, this self-right, not the self-righteous attitude, but this, the entitled, that's the word I'm looking for. You can't come into Islam with this entitled attitude that you're entitled to this, and because you're not. You come into Islam as a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and fulfilling the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and staying away from his prohibitions. You know, you come into the Islam humble, as a humble servant. You don't come in, if you come in entitled and you come in with an ego and you come in with an arrogant attitude, then you're not coming to Islam the way that you're supposed to come in. So first, the person has to be knowledgeable of his actual nature, not how he thinks his nature is, but his actual nature. From the time that you come out of the womb, you've been nothing but dependent. You know, you're dependent on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah didn't even give you the eyesight or the ability to hear, you would not be able to see or hear. How could you even see the Quran or hear the Quran or see a person who's on the truth or hear the truth if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not gift you with those faculties? The hearing and the seeing and the perception that you have and the mind. Imagine that you had the hearing and you had the seeing, but you didn't have the mind. Like there was something that you were born with that your mind just did not function properly. And you cannot assimilate any type of information. So whatever type of, disability they will call this. Imagine now you can see and you can hear, but you can't understand. So the point is all of these are gifts from Allah. And we rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we keep these gifts from Allah. Because our sight, our hearing, and all the things that we have, they will not stay with us except for by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to understand our true nature. Our true nature is that we're impoverished, that we're in need, we're dependent, and we're dependent on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for every single thing, everything. Every breath of air, every sip of water, every piece of crumb of food that we eat, and every thread of clothing on our bodies, we're in need. And like from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us and provide us with these things. And that's the attitude that you have to have coming into Islam. And that's the attitude you have to have staying in Islam. You cannot ever, even if you've been a Muslim for 50 years and you've been praying in the first row in every single salat, you read the Quran every week and you do this and you do this, you pray at night and you fast every Mondays and Thursdays, you're not entitled to anything. You're not entitled to anything. So get that entitled attitude out. That has no place in Islam. You have no rights except for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said in the hadith, where he said, and to Mu'adh ibn, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said in the hadith, to Mu'adh ibn Jabal, when he said, "Tadri ma haqqu Allahi 'ala al-ibadi wa ma haqqu al-ibadi 'ala Allah." And he said, do you know the rights that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has over his servants and the rights that the servants has with Allah? And those rights that the servant has with Allah, and we've gone over this hadith, so there's no point in doing it again, but just to show the meaning here. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has rights over us, and we must fulfill those rights. And then even the rights that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put on himself to give us this if we fulfill his rights. But the main thing is the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we are on this earth to fulfill. So when you come into Islam, you come into Islam with a humble attitude. You come in as a worshiper, as a servant, as a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not as an entitled person who thinks that he's got this bill of rights in Islam and he can do this and he can do this and he has the right to do this. And no, you don't. You have the right to obey the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you obey the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you do that as a humble servant and doing what you're supposed to do, inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will enter you into the paradise. If not, then Allahumma sta'an. Allahumma sta'an. So he said, Ma'rifat ad-din al-Islam bil-adilla al-Islam. He's going to go over this in a second. Bil-adilla. We went over the meaning of al-adilla. It goes back to dalil and the verb adalla ala shay, ma yadulla ala shay. So as we talked about in the beginning of the book, and we went over it, that the adilla in Islam starts with the Quran, the Sunnah, and the ijma' of the Sahaba, and then it goes to qiyas al-sahih. Al-qiyas al-sahih. But the qiyas al-sahih is not an actual dalil, and it's a tabi'. That means it goes back to, it has to follow and be connected to adilla to sahih, going back to the Quran and the Sunnah and the qiyas and the ijma' of the Sahaba. So that's our religion, and that's what our religion, and that's the evidence that our religion is based upon. Our religion is not based upon the opinions of some guy that's wearing a suit and a shaved beard that comes in 2021 and tells us we should do this and we should do that. That is not evidence in our religion. Our religion goes back to the Quran, it goes back to the Sunnah, and it goes back to the ijma' of the Salaf, ijma' of the Sahaba, which are the Salaf. And then that's that. We don't take the opinions that go against the opinions that were held by the Sahaba. If they contradict the opinions of the Sahaba, we do not accept it. No, there's no nobody, even if it's from the Tabi'een, and the Tabi'een were to come and say something that contradictory to what the Sahaba were upon, we don't accept it. So how are we going to accept somebody coming in this day and age now, with shaved beard, pants below the ankles, wearing a suit and tie, and he's going to tell us what Islam is and what Islam isn't, and he's going to go and tell us things that are contradictory to the Quran and Sunnah, and he doesn't even know the Sunnah. He doesn't even know the Sunnah. Never sat down and studied one book of the Sunnah. So the adilla, what we follow, Islam that we follow, it goes back to the Quran, the Sunnah, and the Ijma'. And the Qiyas, it has to be built on those three things. It has to go back to that, and that's the Qiyas al-Sahih. All right. So now, he said, well, who is Islam? Now, he's given the definition and the understanding of Islam. And this is, obviously, this is talking about Islam. And he's giving the meaning in the Sharia, in the Shara'an. He's not giving the meaning in the Arabic language, so he's focusing on what the meaning of Islam is, you know, as a religion. Well, he said, وَهُ لَسْتِ إِسْلَامُ لِلَّهِ بِالتَّوْهِيدِ وَلَنْ قِيَادَ لَهُ بِالطَّاعَةِ وَالْبَرَاءَةُ مِنَ الشِّرْكِ وَأَهْلِهِ وَهُوَ ثَلَاثَ مَرَاتِبٍ. And he's going to go over that. So he said, وَهُ لَسْتِ إِسْلَامُ. لَسْتِ إِسْلَامُ, it means that it's surrendering. Because Islam is to surrender yourself. To surrender yourself and give, like we talked about when we was going over the meaning of deen. And what deen means in the khudur and accepting the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you're surrendering yourself to the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fully. And that's where he said, Alillahi bitawheed. So you completely surrender and you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one. You don't associate any partners. So his commands are the only commands that are obeyed. And his commands, of course, that goes that follows that is the commands of the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because the Messenger of Allah, which is Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was sent by Allah. So his commands follow the commands of Allah. So we obey them. You know, so this is all in obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bitawheed. You know, that we don't commit any forms of shirk or any associate any partners in that obedience and following those commands. So we don't take the commands of somebody else, like the example of the shaved beard guy with the suit. We don't follow his commands and disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we don't follow what these groups and all these people say nowadays. We have all these different groups that pop up every, you know, once a month. With a new group, with a new name, everybody saying something new, and we should do this, and we should follow this. We don't follow that and disobey Allah. We follow the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We follow the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we follow that understanding, the understanding of the companions and the students of the companions and their students, those three generations. And that's our cutoff point. After that, if the person's understanding does not go back to their understanding, then we don't. Then it's not going to be in obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because those are the greatest generations and that's where we get our religion from. So anybody that comes now and says do this and do that, then no, we don't obey them. Because if you obey them in disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, now you know now there's weakness in your tawheed. Because now you're disobeying a creation and disobeying the creator. And that's not the way it goes. And that's why these affairs of tawheed are very, 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 very important. They're very important. Because of that, because look at the types of things that people can fall into. Because every single disobedience that you do to Allah, that you do, you disobey any command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, don't do this, and you do it, that shows weakness in your tawheed. Because it's obedience, because you're obeying your desires and disobeying Allah. That shows weakness in your tawheed. So the istislam and that complete surrendering is where you surrender not just your own desires, your own whims and your own wants and whatever it is that you have. You surrender all that to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You surrender it all to the commands of Allah and following the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because any type of disobedience is a weakness, and it's a weakness in your tawheed. And it's a weakness in your iman. So it has to be fixed. So he said, "Wa lahu al-istislamu lillahi bitawheed wa lan qiyad." And then al-qiyad, it means it's completely like, to completely follow. To completely follow with no disobedience. So when we talk about al-inqiyad, lahu bita'a, that means complete obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in a humble manner, not in a manner where, again, where you start to think like you have this entitled attitude. No, it's a humble, low, as a servant, that you obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all the affairs. And that's al-inqiyad. If you're obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in some things and disobeying them in other things, this is not al-inqiyad. This is not, al-inqiyad is total obedience to the commands of the Creator, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Lahu bita'a, and ta'a, it comes back to, is obedience. Wal bara'a, al bara'a, it means to stay away from, to stay, like to have nothing to do with. Like you say, ana bari'un minhu, ana bari'un minhu, it means I have nothing to do with him. Whatever he does, whatever he says, I have nothing to do with it. Like these liberal Muslims today, we say, nahnu bura'a'u minhum. We have nothing to do with the liberal Muslims. We have nothing to do with what they say or nothing, we have nothing to do with them. Okay, we follow the kitab and the sunnah. He said, "Wa bara'atu min ash-shirk," that you have nothing to do with shirk. You stay completely away from it. Wa ahlihi. Okay, min ash-shirki wa ahlihi, and the people of shirk. So it's not just having nothing to do with shirk, but you have nothing to do with the people who commit shirk. So even if he claims that he's a Muslim, if he claims that he's a Muslim and he's going to the graves and making dua in the graves and he's doing tawaf around graves and he's slaughtering animals and sheep to the graves, we have nothing to do with this individual and his actions. His actions are shirk, and we have nothing to do with this individual and his actions and the shirk that he's committing. We advise him and we try to teach him the religion so he understands, because maybe he has the false understanding that this is Islam. It's not, you know, but maybe this is what he understands. So we try to teach him like this is not from Islam, and we try to sit down with him and see, you know, give him the adilla from the Quran and the Sunnah. But if he refuses to accept it, then we have nothing to do with a person like that. He's committing shirk. He's going to graves. He's doing all this type of foolishness, and we have nothing to do with that. So we have that type of bara'ah is not just from the shirk, but the shirk and the people who commit shirk. So the same thing with the Jews and the Christians. We give them advice. We go out and give them dawah, teach them about Islam. But we have nothing to do with them as far as like you're not participating in their events. They're not our brothers. We're not going to as far as like us living peacefully amongst each other. Yeah, we're not going to run around. We're not terrorists. You know, we're not put on this earth to cause chaos in the land. You know, we're not a physical threat to them, but at the same time, they're not our brothers, and we're not going to hang out with them and go and eat with them and take them as close friends and close companions, you know, and without the believers, expense of not having those companions. We take as our close companions, the believers, and we stay around the believers. We stay around the people that worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَاصْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاتِ وَالْعَشِيِ. You know, فَاصْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ. Stay, like, keep yourself patient with the people. فَاصْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبُّهُمْ. Stay and keep yourself patient in the company of the people that are calling on their Lord at the beginning of the day and the end of the day. And all they want is all they're seeking is the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're only seeking the bounties and everything that's with Allah. They're not seeking anything from the life of this world. Keep yourself patient with these people, even if they're poor, even if they have no status in society. Even if whatever the case may be, but stay patient with these people, because these are the people that are trying to get closer to Allah. And don't worry about the other people. Don't worry about the people that are just trying to build sand castles on the ocean. That once the high tide comes in, it's all going to get destroyed anyways, because that's what they're doing. They're building sand castles on the right on the shore. It's going to get destroyed because all they're trying to build in this life is going to go to nothing. They're going to die and they're going to leave it all behind, and they have nothing in this world. Stay away from those people. Keep yourself patient with the believers. No matter what their status is, no matter what their social level or whatever. So what? You're going to be around people that don't have like high social status, or maybe they don't have a lot of money, but they believe in Allah. They believe in the last day and they're striving to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those are the people you stay around. Those are the people. Those are your companions. Nobody else. Nobody else. He says, so al-bara'atu min ash-shirk wa ahli. Okay, so the whole point is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's what he's ordered us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, in the Quran, he said, inna deena indallahi al-islam. That verily that the religion with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Islam. There's no other religion. There's no other religion. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَنْ يَبْتَغِي غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَنْ يُقْبَلَ مِنْهُ. He said, whoever from amongst the people, he seeks a religion other than Islam, it will never be accepted from him. The only religion on the face of this earth that is accepted right now is al-Islam. The Islam, the Quran, has come and is abrogated every single thing that's gone before it. So nothing, now everything is mansukh that came before it. The only book on the face of this earth that right now is to be acted upon is the Quran. And the Quran orders us to follow. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders us to follow, فَأَطِيُوا اللَّهُ وَأَطِيُوا الرَّسُولُ. How can you obey the Messenger of Allah if you're not following his sunnah? So, and this came in a hadith also with the same type of meaning. And it's a hadith, and Abi Huraira radiallahu anhu, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qala, وَالَّذِي نَفْسُ مُحَمَّدٍ بِيَدِي لَا يَسْمَعُ بِي أَحَدٌ مِنْ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ يَهُودِيٌّ وَلَا نَصْرَانِيٌّ ثُمَّ يُمُوتُ وَلَمْ يُؤْمِن بِالَّذِي أُرْسِلْتُ بِهِ إِلَّا كَانَ مِنْ أَصْحَابِ النَّارِ أَخْرَجَهُ مُسْلِمٌ. So in this hadith, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he reported that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he said, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِ بِيَدِ مُحَمَّدٍ نَفْسُ مُحَمَّدٍ بِيَدِ. He said, by the one in whose hand is the soul of Muhammad, لَا يَسْمَعْ, that nobody from amongst the Jews or the Christians who hears about what I, لَا يَسْمَعُ بِي, that he hears about me and you know what the Prophet ﷺ came with, which is about Islam. And none of them from amongst the Jews or the Christians that hear about the Prophet Muhammad and die, and they didn't believe in him, billahi arsaltu bihi, and he did not believe in what the Prophet was sent with, which is Islam, the Quran, and the Sunnah, illa kana min ashabin nar, except that they were from the people of the hellfire. So that's serious. This is the religion. This is the religion that's the truth. Everything else is not the truth. And that's what we have to come to that understanding. This is not arrogance. This is not anything like how the people think, oh, you guys think that you have the truth and nobody else does. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said it. And we believe that the Quran is from Allah. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said it, then that's what we believe. It's not about us as individuals. We're human beings. We're servants of Allah. We're just doing what we're commanded. And we're saying what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said because that's what we're commanded to do. And also, as far as the Islam is concerned, Islam is complete. And it's a complete religion. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَلْيَمَّ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمْ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا. So today, on this day, I've completed for you your religion, دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي, and I have perfected and completed my favor upon you, my blessing upon you. وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمْ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا, and I am pleased that Islam for you is Islam as a religion. That Islam being a religion for you, that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with. So again, nobody comes in this day and age and says anything except for an understanding that the people that had that understanding, like the understanding of the people before that ayat was revealed. At the time that ayat was revealed, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that he's completed this religion, we don't accept another understanding of a person coming and saying, oh, well, no, this is not halal, this is not haram, this is okay to do. And then the people in the time of the Sahaba understood that it was something haram. For example, shaving the beard. You know, we have all the different ahadith, inshallah, that we're going to go through in Bulugh al-Maram that deal with the hadith, that deal with the wujub, that it's an obligation to have the beard. And then these people come later on and say, oh no, it's not an obligation, it's just a sunnah. And then they try to play it down like that. But that's not the understanding of the Sahaba. And that's not the understanding of the Tabi'in. That's not the understanding of the Sahaba when that ayat was sent down. So what type of religion are they coming with now? Where they start to make certain obligations, they start to make them not an obligation anymore, and they start to make things that are haram, they start to make them not haram anymore. You know, like the musical instruments and music, and now all of a sudden now the music's become, it went from being haram to makruh. Now it's like, now it's almost mustahab now. So this, the religion of Islam, is a religion based on the Quran and the Sunnah according to the understanding of the Sahaba and the two generations that came after the Sahaba, not according to anybody else. And this time, if it goes against their understanding. So what was haram for them is haram for us. What was halal for them was halal for us. What was wajib for them is wajib for us. What was makruh for them is makruh for us. And that's the way it's going to be until the Day of Judgment. You know, so we don't allow anybody to come in and tell us anything different. You know, because all the people that come in and change their religion after this ayah, this goes back to the hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha, in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he said, "Man ahdatha fi amrina hadha ma laysa minhu fa huwa radd." And also in another narration where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man amila amalan laysa alayhi amruna fa huwa radd." So in the hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man ahdatha," and al-ahdatha, it means al-bid'ah, it means to introduce something new to the religion that's not from the religion. Okay? Like this, the Sahaba, they understood that this was wajib to have a beard. And this person comes in and says, no, it's not wajib. It's not wajib. It's just a sunnah. This is now called ahdatha fi amrina. He's now come and introduced something new to the religion. Because that opinion wasn't the opinion of the Sahaba. That wasn't the opinion of the Tabi'in. And that wasn't the opinion of the Tabi'a Tabi'in. In fact, that wasn't the opinion of the Imma. If you go back to Ahl al-Hadith, the Imma of Ahl al-Hadith, nobody had that opinion. Okay, some people might have an opinion of like trimming it, you know, like after a handful, like Sheikh Albani, Allah yirhamu, he had that type of opinion, but that's not the stronger opinion, even to trim it, that you leave the beard, because those are the ahadith. So for that person to come and say something other than that, then he's introduced something into Islam that's not from Islam, called ahdatha fi amrina, huwa. So now he's introduced something into this religion, for who? He said, for huwa rad. Rad, it means it's rejected, because rad here, it means maradud ala sahibi, that he will not get any ajr for this. That anything that he does in worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not sent down on his from that ayah right there, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that his religion, that this religion is complete, at that point, and he's doing an action that's not according to Islam at that point, and now he's doing something new, then it will be rejected from him and that will not be accepted. And on top of that, he's gonna have a sin for doing what he's doing and going against, especially if he has knowledge or claiming or calling the people to that misguidance. So we have to be, this is Islam. And this is our Islam. And Islam is, it's Islam. It means that we surrender ourselves to the Quran and to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His commands. His commands in the Quran and His commands on the tongue of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and His Sunnah and the authentic Sunnah. So we go back and we look at the authentic Sunnah and whatever is from the authentic and it's agreed upon amongst the ulama of hadith, that this hadith is sahih, that's our action. That's what we do. And we don't do anything else what these people say and it's not in accordance with that. And we reject anything that's not in accordance with the Quran and the Sunnah and the way of the Salaf al-Saleh. And when we talk about the Salaf al-Saleh, the first Salaf is Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He is the first of the Salaf. And then the Sahaba. And then the two generations that came after the Sahaba. That's our religion. That's Islam. That's what we follow. And we follow that in a completely humble nature. And in complete obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we have given up all of our desires and all of our wants and wishes, and we've given it up to the obedience of the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's our religion, and that's what we want to follow, and that's what we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the tawfiq, because that is the sirat al-mustaqim. And the only one that will give us the tawfiq to stay on the sirat al-mustaqim is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So He's the one that we have to like, nasta'inu bihi da'iman, sabahan wa masa'an, constantly seeking the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to stay on this sirat, to stay on this path until our deaths and until we die upon this. الله هو الموافق وإلى هنا سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك